Tracy Sable tonight on EWTN News Nightly. Rising death toll. An update on the massive earthquake in Turkey and Syria and what an international Catholic aid organization is doing to help. Focus on the unborn. President Joe Biden is set to deliver the State of the Union address. We have a preview, including the role abortion will play in the remarks. A moral obligation. What the governor of Tennessee is doing to help the state's pro-life pregnancy centers. And war on woke. Florida Governor Ron DeSantis makes an announcement about the state's public education. These stories and more tonight.
From EWTN, the Global Catholic Network, this is EWTN News Nightly.
Thank you for being with us tonight. Our top story, a frantic race in Turkey and Syria tonight to find survivors and help the injured in the aftermath of an earthquake that has now claimed more than 7,000 lives. The 7.8 magnitude quake hit Monday. Rescuers worked in freezing temperatures and sometimes used their bare hands to dig through the remains of flattened buildings. More than 70 countries have pledged to help. The Vatican has started a relief fund for victims of the Turkey-Syria earthquake. Funds will also go to support missionary priests, religious women, and others assisting on the ground. The Holy Father also continues to pray for those impacted. In a tweet, Pope Francis said, quote, I remain close with all my heart to the people affected by the earthquake in Turkey and Syria. I continue to pray for those who have lost their lives, as well as the injured family members and rescuers. May our concrete aid sustain them in the midst of this appalling tragedy. And joining us tonight with more is Edward Clancy, Director of Outreach for Aid to the Church in Need. Ed, great to have you on. Thanks so much for being here. As we mentioned, thank the you. Death toll, unfortunately, is quickly mounting, and rescue workers, as you know, are in a race against time. What are you hearing from your folks on the ground in Turkey and Syria? What's the latest, Ed?
Pretty much the same. It's a race against time to save the wounded and those who are trapped. And the numbers, unfortunately, keep going up. There's still quite a number of people missing. The big thing now is the weather. People are stranded. They're afraid to go into their homes. They're afraid to go into any buildings until they're reviewed. And even then, sometimes an engineer's report is not enough to give people confidence to go inside. So there's a lot of stress and a lot of problems. And unfortunately, it's cold and people are in need of a good deal of help.
Yeah, and there are reports of deaths among many Christians and Catholics in places like Aleppo and Hama. As you know, the body of Father Imad Dahir was pulled from his collapsed residence yesterday, and sadly, he didn't survive. In that same home, I understand that one of your colleagues, Monsignor Jean-Clement Gimbard, was injured and is in the hospital. Ed, do you know how he's doing right now? Do you have any updates on his condition?
He's stable. He's getting some medical treatments. They're not really telling us too much more than his condition is stable. He did suffer some wounds that they don't appear to be life-threatening. But when you reach 80 years old, every little wound can be a problem. And obviously, the healthcare system in Syria is stressed. And even though he might be getting the best care, there's only limitations there because of what's going on.
Yeah, we'll continue to keep him in our prayers and everyone else over there as well. What about the status of the churches over there, Ed, as well as the soup kitchens and the elderly homes that you all operate? Were they impacted in any way?
Yes, they were. There are some that are safe. We have one with the Syrian Hope Center. They are in good condition. And a few of the buildings on the outskirts are seemingly unaffected. The issue always is now, though, that they have to have engineers come in and make sure that there are no structural problems, because it can look fine. But if there's foundation problems or there's cracks somewhere not seen, and there's numerous tremors that keep happening, so there's a chance that there could be a problem. So we're responding immediately with using some of the emergency tents for distribution of food. We are working with the communities on the ground, the Mechorists, as well as the Franciscans, and we will expand that that group as more and more filter in to tell us what is needed. Our goal is to help the people who are in direst need first, and then eventually move towards getting them resettled and then hopefully back into homes that are safe.
Yeah, and as we know, you know, even before this earthquake hit, Christians in that part of the world, they were really suffering tremendously. We don't have a whole lot of time left, Ed, but I'm wondering if you can briefly walk us through what they were facing even before this disaster hit.
Well, it's a very long history, unfortunately. We're talking about over a decade of problems. Back in 2011 was the beginning of the Civil War. And unfortunately, because the Christian communities tended to occupy some of the areas that were controlled by Assad, it meant that not only did they have to face the rebel attacks, but then after that, they had to face sanctions. So a lot of times it was difficult for them to get aid. And then you have the situation in Lebanon with the collapse of the economy there. Lebanon had been a lifeline, and now Lebanon's on life support. So it's a multi-tiered problem. And then you also have many years of bombing. You had terrorist attacks. And you have a community that is, you know, in a sense, being stressed and stretched in every possible way. So right now, the issue is it's to keep them there, to keep them surviving, keep them well. And that's our first goal. And then after that, we will go to helping them in other areas like rebuilding churches and things like that. But it's going to be first dealing with the people's immediate needs, dealing with their homes, and then moving towards the community and helping to rebuild and maintain it there.
And before I let you go, quickly, you know, where do we go from here and how can we all help?
Well, if you go to churchinneed.org, we're going to help them in the best way that we can. We've committed over $60 million in the last dozen years because of all the problems there. And we look at Syria as one of those places where we can't let go. It's where Christians were first called Christians. And as Archbishop John Bart once told me, he says, people say to me, can you bring a relic? I just bring the dirt, because that's the very dirt that the apostles walked on. This place is a holy land. This place is part of what Jesus did in his life, as well as the apostles.
Ed, thank you so much for coming on tonight and sharing all this with us. We really appreciate it. God bless you, and God bless you,
thank you
for what you do.
Yes, and please pray for the people in Syria.
And we will, for sure. A Catholic priest in Nicaragua has been sentenced to 10 years in prison. Father Oscar Benavidez was found guilty of conspiracy and spreading fake news about President Daniel Ortega's regime. Human rights groups are raising the alarm over the growing number of political prisoners in the Central American nation. The White House did not list abortion as one of President Joe Biden's main talking points at the State of the Union tonight. However, the topic is still ever present. Some of the guests invited to watch the speech in the House chamber are directly tied to the issue. White House correspondent Owen Jensen begins our team coverage tonight. Owen.
Tracy, tonight, First Lady Jill Biden will sit in the balcony alongside several people, all invited to make a point. One of them, a woman from Texas, who says she was temporarily denied medical care because of a Texas pro-life law.
When President Joe Biden speaks tonight, he'll face a divided Congress, which is why the White House says the president will promote his so-called unity agenda. A preview of the State of the Union says the president wants to end cancer as we know it, tackle the mental health crisis, and support America's veterans. In the Biden administration's view, that includes offering abortion counseling and, in certain cases, abortions to pregnant veterans and VA beneficiaries. But pro-life advocates stand ready to fight.
The abortion lobby has not backed down, and the fight is not over. We must defend our pro-life laws and ensure more protections for the unborn and their mothers. We will not cease until we change hearts and minds.
When it comes to the economy, President Biden told us he takes no blame for inflation. His economic advisor added yesterday,
the principal drivers of inflation have been the pandemic globally and subsequent shocks to the system, the most significant of which was the war in Ukraine.
The president also told us yesterday he takes no blame for mishandling classified documents, although he did say,
we'll wait till you get the whole report.
On social media, President Biden urging Americans to watch tonight.
Members of Congress and the cabinet, Justice of the Supreme Court, my fellow Americans.
And immediately following, with the Republican response, former White House Press Secretary Sarah Huckabee Sanders, who was recently sworn in as governor of Arkansas. She said she wants to contrast the GOP's optimistic vision for the future against the failures of President Biden and the Democrats, and defend our freedom against the radical left.
Now, President Biden had nothing on his public schedule today. Obviously, he's been getting ready for his speech tonight. The White House says President Biden will also address the opioid epidemic, gun violence, and police reform, among other topics. At the White House, Owen Jensen, EWTN News Nightly.
Now, the president is expected to spotlight all the good that he has done for the American people in his State of the Union address tonight. But Republicans are already firing away at his failures, from inflation and the economy to the crisis at the southern border. Capitol Hill correspondent Eric Rosales joins us now with the latest. Eric.
Well, good evening, Trace. You know, Capitol Hill is ready for President Biden's State of the Union address tonight. To say security is tight is an understatement. Take a look at this. A heavy police presence out there and a 7-foot fence is up around the entire Capitol grounds. While Democrats say that the president will outline his accomplishments and his direction for the future, Republicans tell me that they don't expect much.
Out of control, soaring inflation, still a record high. We have an open border. We have a Chinese spy balloon that was allowed to float across our country. We had a disastrous withdrawal from Afghanistan. So we've had all of those things happen under President Biden's leadership, and I'm hopeful he has some solutions.
He's going to get on camera and make it appear as though he has accomplished great things for our country. Again, I just don't see it.
Democrats say the president has a lot to be proud of.
I'm looking forward hearing President Biden later today about the amazing progress we've made in improving the lives of American families and to hear his vision for the next 2 years.
Democrats are using the State of the Union to reaffirm their party's commitment to codify Roe. Massachusetts lawmakers have invited an abortion doctor and a woman who they say was forced to travel across state lines to get an abortion. On the other side, Republican Congressman Scott Perry of Pennsylvania has invited Mark Houck, a pro-life leader who was arrested and later acquitted for an altercation outside an abortion clinic. Catholic Congressman French Hill's guest is the chair of the U.S. Commission on International Religious Freedom, Nuri Turkel, a vocal advocate for religious groups facing persecution in China.
Nuri can tell you every aspect of the systematic genocide of the Uyghur people in China, including his own parents have been essentially trapped there. And he's blessed he can still speak to his mom by telephone, but he may never see her again.
That is a very sad situation there. You know, the question that many Republican lawmakers are asking, will President Biden call for unity like he's done throughout his presidency? They tell me that the president and Democrats on Capitol Hill continue to bash a large portion of Republicans using words like MAGA extremists. Again, the speech will get started at 9 o'clock tonight. From the Capitol, Eric Rosales, EWTN News Nightly.
We have a lot more still to come here on EWTN News Nightly, including a moral obligation. The governor of Tennessee unveils a plan to help pro-life pregnancy centers. And how the governor of Florida is tackling woke culture in the state's public education. In the state of Massachusetts has published a report about clergy sexual abuse. It found that in the Diocese of Worcester, between 1950 and 2022, there were 209 allegations of clergy abuse. 96% of them occurred before 1990. The report did not name the accused priests. The Republican governor of Tennessee has unveiled a plan to give tens of millions of dollars to pro-life centers. Governor Bill Lee says that he is creating a $100 million grant program for pregnancy centers. He also proposed expanding paid parental leave for state employees and broadening Medicaid eligibility for parents and pregnant women. Governor Lee says the state has a moral obligation to support families. In Florida, Governor Ron DeSantis is stepping up the state's war on woke with a plan to defund critical race theory and diversity and inclusion initiatives at the state's public universities. The governor also plans to up the power of the state's university presidents to hire and fire professors who do or do not comply. The Florida State Legislature will review the proposal in March. And joining us tonight to discuss is Evita Duffy with The Federalist. Evita, great to have you with us. Let's get right to it. Why do you think these diversity initiatives and teachings like critical race theory are such a danger to our schools and our children?
Yeah, thank you so much for having me. So I got the foundational critical race theory texts when I was a freshman in college. They're from the 70s or 80s, and they were taught like regular philosophers. Like you would read Aristotle, you would read Plato, you would read Karl Marx. That's how they're taught, the right way. The problem is that the way that they teach CRT, especially as you get into the younger levels, you're in middle school, high school, elementary school, it's taught as fact. And this is a school of thought. It's a way of viewing the world. It's a very racist, a very bad way of viewing the world, in my opinion. But the problem is they're not giving students the opportunity to weigh whether this is an accurate way of seeing things, and instead just presenting it as fact. And it's become extremely detrimental. And on the college level, they've made it so that it's embedded into the system. So you have these critical race theory inspired committees for every single one of the departments, so that then they're able to teach this ideology to students who otherwise wouldn't get it. So in like the science department, the math department, and they're also using it to impact hiring processes. So in the name of CRT, in the name of equity, diversity, and inclusion, they're having a social justice litmus test for who should be hired instead of who's the best person for the job. And DeSantis is saying that's not going to happen in Florida anymore. I'm not going to allow this, our, you know, taxpayers to fund this. And I think it's a really good move on his part.
Yeah. And do you expect his plan to get traction in Florida? And also, do you think other states may follow suit?
Yeah, I think if it's going to happen anywhere, it's going to happen in Florida. He's done an amazing job of leading that state. And I think the legislature is on his side. I think they're going to pass his you know, proposed bill. But I think other states, it's a little more difficult. For instance, in Wisconsin, it's where I'm from. We have a Democrat governor. There are some, I think, where you'll see the most traction instead of sort of these big sweeping you know, pieces of legislation is actually really on the roots. So you have parents rising up and saying, hey, we're going to actually fight this on the school board level. We're going to, you know, show up to these school board meetings and talk about it. I'm going to be more involved in what my kids are learning and ask to see their homework and maybe even lobby to get cameras in the classroom so we know exactly what's being taught. And I think that's really where you're going to see this change is on a real individualized level. And I think that is even more encouraging than this legislation, because really this is about parents taking back control of the classroom.
Evita, we're almost out of time, but I really want to get this in. As you know, tonight President Biden is going to deliver his State of the Union address. He's expected to touch on the war in Ukraine, the economy, and crime. And I know you've been following a city very closely that's really kind of been the epicenter of crime, and that's Chicago. What can you tell us about what is going on in the streets there?
Yeah, well, I mean, Chicago is a disaster. I went to school there. I went to the University of Chicago. I was there for 4 years, and crime has increasingly gotten worse under the leadership of Lori Lightfoot. She was elected in 2019. People are pistol whipped, shot. I've had several of my classmates have been shot, several killed, and it's a very terrifying situation. And there's a mass exodus in Chicago, and it's the same for a lot of many liberal cities in this country, and in LA and in New York. People just don't want to live there anymore. And I think really until they start seeing the real economic hit of this exodus, will they start to change their ways. But as of right now, it's a disaster. And unfortunately, the people that can get out, and the people that can't because they can't afford to end up staying. And so the people that get hurt the most are actually poor, oftentimes minorities, which is very ironic because those are the people that Lori Lightfoot and J.B. Pritzker say they want to help. So it's a very sad situation.
Yeah, absolutely. We're out of time. So much more we could talk about. We'll have to get you back on. Evita, thanks so much. Great to hear your insights.
Thank you.
Up next on EWTN News Nightly, highly anticipated ruling. Spain's High Court is set to weigh in on an abortion case. Plus, an update for the faithful in war-torn Ukraine. In Spain is set to issue a ruling on abortion after 13 years. The justices inside this building are considering the appeal of a measure that would make it easier for women to get an abortion. Spain's conservative party, with support from the Catholic Church, filed the appeal back in 2010. It was in response to a measure passed by the country's then socialist government. There is no timetable for a court decision. Leaders from Australia and New Zealand met today to discuss their concerns over the growing threat from China.
Our position on China is clear, that we will cooperate where we can, we'll disagree where we must, and we'll engage in our national interests.
Australian Prime Minister Anthony Albanese said that his country's national interests include restoring good trade and economic relations with Beijing. New Zealand's Prime Minister pushed back on a suggestion that his country has been slow to stand up to bad behavior from the communist government in China. While the Ukrainian Catholic Church is moving away from a church calendar affiliated with Russia. The move means that Ukrainian Catholics will now celebrate Christmas on December 25th. They previously celebrated on January 7th, the same day as many Orthodox faiths who follow the Julian calendar. For now, the faithful in Ukraine will continue to celebrate Easter on a later date from most of the world's Catholics and Protestant Christians. Joining us now from Rome is Andreas Tannhauser, EWTN Vatican Bureau Chief. Andreas, great to see you as always. Can you tell us more about that and why this change of date is significant?
In a change of tradition, the Ukrainian Greek Catholic Church has just announced recently that it will follow from now on the Western Gregorian calendar with regard to Christmas. For the first time, Ukrainian Greek Catholics will celebrate Christmas this year in 2023 on December the 25th and not on January the 7th. So this change is significant because it bears witness to a general trend in war-torn Ukraine. Of course, we shouldn't forget that we're speaking here about a small portion of the whole population. Less than 10% attend this Greek Catholic Church, which is united with Rome. The Ukrainian Orthodox Church is the big Christian church in the country. It broke away from the Russian Orthodox Church in 2019, a move which might have fueled additional tensions between Russia and Ukraine. The adoption of the Gregorian calendar by the Greek Catholic Church in Ukraine is seen as a move towards the West. And many expect also the much bigger Ukrainian Orthodox Church to follow this example and no longer celebrate Christmas in January as faithful in Russia do.
So, Andreas, it seems that politics plays a big role in the Orthodox churches in Ukraine.
Yeah, that is absolutely true. Politics do play a big role here as well, like on a geopolitical level, also on a church level, there's a lot seems to be politically charged. The Russian Orthodox Patriarch Kirill has very clearly shown his support for Russian President Vladimir Putin and the war in Ukraine. The Russian church never accepted the split of the Ukrainian Orthodox Church, but the church's independence was recognized by Ecumenical Patriarch Bartholomew of Constantinople. And so, as we can see, there's a widening gap and tension between the Orthodox churches that are either Eastern or Western oriented. The war in Ukraine drove the faithful even further away from the Russian Orthodox influence. And also, Cardinal Kurt Koch, who is here in the Vatican, the head of the Dicastery for the Promotion of Christian Unity, he told us also that it is very, very concerning, actually, to see this drifting apart of the different Orthodox churches, so much so that in the Ukraine, more and more faithful will celebrate this year's Christmas at a new date.
All right, Andreas, thank you so much for that report. Always appreciate it. Andreas Tannhauser, EWTN Vatican Bureau Chief. Thank you again. And we thank you for watching tonight. Remember, you can follow us on social media, Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at EWTN News Nightly. I'm Tracy Sable. Good night, and God bless.